The Wycherley Book Company presents Inspector Hobbes and the Curse. Unhuman, Book 2, by Wilkie Martin. Read by Tim Campbell. 1. When I drew Hobbes's attention to the unpleasant, if somewhat underwhelming, article on the front page of the Sorinchester and District Bugle, neither of us could have foreseen the deadly and bizarre events it heralded. The next few weeks were to prove among the most painful, frightening, and horrific of my life, taking me to dark places I would have given almost anything to have avoided. I was at the time having to live at Hobbes's, sleeping in his spare room, jobless, broke, and pretty low. Mrs. Goodfellow, his housekeeper, had left us to fend for ourselves while she attended a dental conference in Norwich. She wasn't actually a dentist, merely obsessed by teeth, having amassed a collection of several thousand. To start with, things had been fine, for she'd prepared meals to heat up, but we'd devoured the last one the previous night, and I'd volunteered as stand-in cook, having made a passing study of the old girl's culinary technique during the months I'd been staying there. Admittedly, my experience had been mostly confined to hanging around, getting in her way, and eating whatever she prepared. Yet I'd been quietly confident I'd absorbed enough and could cope, so it had seemed only fair that I, as a non-paying guest, should help out. Hobbes, to his credit, had let me get on with it on a trial basis. Breakfast had been a doddle, there being little I could do wrong with sugar puffs and marmalade on toast. My first big test was lunch. Since we'd been surprised by a burst of intense summer, I'd opted as a first attempt for simplicity. I threw together a salad and cold meats, using up a few leftovers and adding some green stuff from the garden. Unfortunately, it hadn't looked sufficient for me, never mind for Hobbes's vast appetite. And so I'd decided to make a nice gazpacho, using a recipe I'd spotted in Sorinchester Life. This, I thought, combined with our remaining bread, would fill the void. Taking advantage of the fine weather, I served the meal beneath the fractured shade of the knobbly old apple tree in the middle of the luxuriant, flower-scented back garden. After Hobbes, according to his custom, had said grace, his voice competing against the buzzing of countless bees, I handed him the salad, which was, in my opinion, not bad. Certainly he ate his without fuss, seeming not to mind the big green caterpillar on the lettuce, and he even complimented me on its freshness. He did, however, point out that the potatoes in a potato salad are better when cooked. Then, proudly, I ladled out the gazpacho, its blood-red hue and tingling aroma of herbs and spice a promise of excellence. Yet, from my first spoonful, it was obvious something had gone terribly wrong, resulting in a weirdly unpleasant, meaty flavour that, combined with a nasty grittiness, caught the throat and turned the stomach. Hobbes only got as far as sniffing his, before, aiming a puzzled frown in my direction, he headed towards the kitchen. Sitting on a garden bench, watching the ants avoiding a spot of soup I'd spilled, I tried to figure out where I'd gone wrong, following a recipe the magazine claimed to be foolproof. So far as I could remember, I'd followed the instructions precisely, using only fresh vegetables and, being short of tomatoes, a big squirt of tomato puree. Although my soup had come out considerably redder than the photograph, I'd put it down to the printer, saving on red ink. When Hobbes returned, carrying an immense slab of cheese and pickles sandwich, he tossed the tomato puree tube in front of me with an amused snort. Except it wasn't tomato puree at all, but the dog's meat-flavoured toothpaste. Hobbes, grinning at my shudder of revulsion, my look of despair, took a bite from his sandwich and sat chewing. On finishing, he suggested it would be better if we ate out, or bought in takeaways, until the old girl got home. I couldn't argue, merely taking myself to the kitchen to make a pot of tea, a task at which I'd become reasonably adept. I'd just picked up the Sorinchester and District Bugle, when Hobbes, sauntering in from the garden, helped himself to a steaming mugful of tea from the pot I'd made. Chucking in a handful of sugar, he stirred it with his great hairy forefinger, relaxed into the battered old chair next to mine, stretched out his thick legs, took a quick slurp, and placed his mug on the kitchen table.
Let's hope, he said, grimacing, that the lass returns before you finish both of us off. I shrugged, trying not to feel more inadequate than usual, for I was really doing my best in the absence of Mrs. Goodfellow, and, pointing at the front page, changed the subject. According to this, there was blood everywhere.
Whose blood?
The sheep's, I suppose. What do you reckon did it? Frowning, he scratched the side of his bull neck.
The very beginning is a very good place to start. About what are you talking?
This. I pushed the paper towards him. Taking it, he scanned the article, his bristling eyebrows plunging into a scowl.
You want me to tell you what killed it, even though you've got all the information I have?
I nodded. Well, you are a detective. He smiled.
All right, I'll do what I can, though there's precious little to go on. First point, yesterday morning a farmer found a sheep dead in a field just off the main road to Pigden. Second point, its throat had been torn out. Third point, it had been partially eaten. Those are the facts. The rest is filler.
It was, I thought, a good summary, though the reporter had managed to inflate the story to cover half the front page, while hinting at dark mysteries. Still, sheep killed was not among the snappiest headlines Rex Witcherly, the editor, or editorsaurus as I called him, had come up with, and the blurry photograph of a sheep in a field entitled A Sheep in a Field that occupied most of the rest of the page was not the most creative idea he'd had. To be fair to the editorsaurus, it wasn't always easy to find hot news in a small Cotswold town like Sorinchester. Furthermore, he'd been going through a tough time since his wife got herself locked up in a secure unit for attempting to murder Hobbes, me, and others the previous November, and wasn't yet back on form. Hobbes, taking another swig from his mug, continued,
I suspect a dog might be to blame, possibly a stray, because when pet dogs run wild, they're less likely to eat what they kill. Anyway, there's nothing I can do about it, unless there are further incidents.
Dregs, Hobbes's delinquent dog, padded in through the open back door, his long pink tongue snaking out to lick a blood-red globule dripping from his shaggy black muzzle. He slumped onto the cool red brick floor with a sigh, wagging his tail as if he'd just done something clever. Look, I cried, my finger trembling as I pointed. It was him. But he's always well fed. Hobbes's laugh rumbled round the kitchen.
You'd be hard-pressed to make the charge stick, since he was with me at the station at the alleged time of the incident. Furthermore, if you observe more closely, you'll notice that it's not blood, but your interesting tomato soup round his chops. You shouldn't jump to wild conclusions.
I flinched and said nothing, wallowing in a familiar sense of failure. It was worse that this time I had really tried. At length, draining his mug, he got to his feet.
I'd better be off, he said. Superintendent Cooper asked me to have a word with Skeleton Bob Niblet. Do you fancy a trip out?
Yeah, why not? What's he been up to this time?
Same as usual, poaching.
Well, I said, you can't blame him. He looks like he needs the meat. Bob's hollow eyes, sparse frame, and skull-like head were familiar to Bugle readers. His frequent appearances before the magistrate providing the crime desk with a constant trickle of small news. His offences, always petty, usually detected early in their inception, meant he would never be regarded as a criminal genius. Yet he had a reputation as an excellent poacher, and according to pub rumours, supplied many respectable people with illicit game. Hobbes led Dregs and me from number 13 Black Dog Street toward his rusting blue Ford Fiesta. As we got in, I wondered why I was always relegated to the cramped back seat whenever the dog travelled with us. In a way, I was glad of this inferior position, for Hobbes's maniacal driving, showing no signs of abating, meant I enjoyed a slight sense of security when cowering in the rear, reasoning that the chances of him reversing into a tree at breakneck speed were considerably less than those of smacking into one at full speed ahead. Dregs, on the other hand, showed every confidence in Hobbes's abilities, and, to give him his due, the facts backed up his nonchalance. For no one I'd ask.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.